The next presentation would be from Mr. Nil.
Yeah.
Geoinformatics demonstration on and of an example with QGIS.
Thank you, sir. So I'll be just taking a brief problem statement on generation of healthcare indicator maps using QGIS. And with this, I'll also go through the basics of QGIS. So initially, I had just planned on going for the healthcare indicator, which is more of a GIS-based problem statements. But after seeing the comment section where a lot of people are interested on how to load the remote sensing data sets onto the QGIS platform, so I'll give a brief introduction on QGIS using the Indian remote sensing data sets like AVIS and how to calculate some basic indices. Then I'll proceed to this problem statement. So this has already been taken by Penances, so I will not take much time on this. I'll just highlight that it is an open source software which has been under development for over 15 years. So it is under active development for over 15 years. And the community is very strong, and it has a very strong project steering committee also. The problem statement here which I'll be taking is the generation of healthcare indicator maps, so wherein we can also identify the gap areas in the health infrastructure. Also, if time permits, we can find out the suitable locations where the new health infrastructures can be established. And here you can take the IRS data sets and Cartosat data. We'll be using products from the Cartosat data. Also some administrative boundaries and hospital data sets, village locations with population information, and road networks. So this is a two-phase statement. So for generation of the healthcare indicator, we'll be calculating the population density and the number of hospitals per population. Also, we'll be identifying the gap areas in the healthcare infrastructure. Further, for the criteria of the new hospitals, if we consider, if we have to consider it closer to the existing roads, away from the existing hospital, away from the sloping areas, and in areas where the population density is pretty high. So the key learning outcomes would be the ability to work with different types of spatial data sets and visualize and analyze the location-based data sets, integrate the spatial data into your data science workflow, ability to use QGIS for mapping and spatial analysis, and solve some complex spatial analysis problems. So from now, I'll quickly go to the QGIS window. So I'm using a Linux-based system here, but for everyone who's using a Windows-based system, they can just go to the Windows Start button and type QGIS, and you can find the QGIS table version. Also, in a Linux-based system, you can just scroll down or just search here, QGIS. And I'm using the LTR, long-term release version, that is 3.10. So the QGIS software gets an update every 3 months. And this is the stable version, which was released in the last March it was released. So this is the basic window, if we see the QGIS window here. And it consists of this layer visualization panel. If I just click here, this opens an empty project template. On the right side here, I have the different toolbox, which is either native to the QGIS platform or third party. So all the ones which we have, which have the Q logo in front. So these are native tools to the QGIS. And the ones which have different icons, those are third-party tools. So herein we can see GDAL and GRASS have been integrated with the QGIS platform to perform give it some additional capabilities. So a lot of raster handling capabilities onto the QGIS platform is done using GDAL only. On the left here, we have the browser panel. Here we can actually browse the location or our system, and we can go to the different file paths, and we can directly open the layers. The moment the layers are opened, you can visualize the layers onto this platform, that is the layer tree. There are a couple of things, interesting things in QGIS also. So like you can, it comes out of the box with OpenStreetMap WMS services. So you can just go to the browser panel, click here XYZ tiles, click on the OSM, and it opens up the OpenStreetMap WMS. Now, just as an Easter egg for the QGIS, if you want to know who are the contributors to the QGIS, you can just type contributors on the bottom here on the coordinate and just type enter. And and you'll be getting the QGIS contributors populated onto the map. So this is just an Easter egg. If someone is interested, he can look into where are from which all places in the world, people across the world, they are contributing to this project. I'll just remove this layer. Now I'll straight away go and load a raster layer. Now, Arul Raj sir has already mentioned how to download the different remote sensing data sets. So I have already downloaded and kept a remote sensing data set, that is AWS data, for 2 days. So there are multiple ways you can actually download this, load this data set onto this QGIS platform. The simplest way would be like you can directly go to the location and you can drag and drop this layers. So I can just select all, I can drag and drop them here. Now you can see here I've downloaded a layer for the northeastern region. So this is the AWS data for the northeastern region, and all the four bands of AWS data has been populated. This data is of 8th February 2009. Now, one of the very standard practices what we do in remote sensing is the moment we load this layer, we do a layer stack. So a standard practice in commercial software like would be to do a layer stack here, but here the process is a little different. We do something called as a build virtual raster. Okay, so I go to the top here, the raster menu, I click miscellaneous, I do a build virtual raster, then I can select all my bands here, click here, and I can give it a name, like I can give it AWS 2009. And the moment I do that, I can see here the map has been populated with the layer stacked information. And onto this layer panel, if you see on the top left, there's a styling panel available. So there's a brush tool here. So you can go ahead and click on this brush tool. And then what I can do is I can change the band combinations as per my requirement. So I can go and do a 3, 2, and 1 and do a standard false color composite. So here I can visualize the water bodies and the dense vegetated areas, and the agricultural patches are also seen here. And similarly, I can calculate the NDVI for this particular scene. So I'll go ahead and calculate the NDVI for that particular scene also. So the formula for NDVI is NIR minus red by NIR plus red. So I'll just go ahead and do an band 4 minus 3 and divided by band 4. Plus band 3. So if I do this, I can get 2009. I'll just type here NDVI 2009. I'll just save it and click OK. And within a few clicks of button, the NDVI is calculated and I can visualize this NDVI. I can also give a style to this NDVI. So you can see here, by default, it is styled in the single band gray color. So I can give it a pseudo color, and this color palette is generated, which is based on a linear scale. So based on a linear scale, we are getting a color palette where the red represents the low vegetated or the water bodies, and the green represents the highly vegetated areas. In addition to this, I can also load some vector layers on top of this, and I can do some clipping operation also. So another way of adding a layer is not by simply dragging and dropping. You can go to layers, add vector layer, and just go to, I've selected my AOI, and I can visualize my AOI here. So this is the way I can actually load my vector layer here, and I can give it a say transparent fill, and I can also change the stroke color. So all these functionalities are available in QGIS directly off the shelf. And I can also clip the NDVI which I've prepared just now using this vector file. So I can go ahead and do a type here, clip on top here. And I, in this GDAL tools, so what happens is, you see here there are two tools here, vector overlay and raster extraction. So in the GDAL tool, you have to go to clip raster by mask layer. So the moment I click raster by mask layer, what happens here is I can load the NDVI input, and the mask layer is also loaded. And on the bottom here, we are actually seeing the GDAL command, which will actually run in the background and help us clip this image into this AOI. So this is how the QGIS is actually working in the backend. So if you don't actually want to use this software, you can basically install the GDAL into your system, and you can run this command also, and this command will automatically clip your image based on this platform.
Hello.
So we can see here, the image is already clipped. Okay. So this is how it is clipped, and we can visualize this in the QGIS software. I can also generate the print for this. So how do I go ahead and generate the print map for this? I can go ahead and go to projects and type new print. And I can give the print layout some value, like I can give it test, and I can click OK. And then here, what I can do is I can add maps. Okay, go to the top, add item, add map. And the moment I do that, the map is already added. And this can be augmented with other functionalities, such as we can add a scale bar here. We can add a north arrow here. We can also add the legend here. So we can see here, there's a legend bar here. So it is very much intuitive. Now, if you don't want all these values to be populated, what you can do is, there's this button here called auto update. All you have to do is you have to uncheck it, and we have to remove all the others which are not required. So automatically, all the layers which are not required in the legend will be removed. So basically, you are able to create maps within a few clicks of a button here. Now, also, if I want to generate a grid for this map, like I want to have a outline here. So how do I go about that? I can simply go here, add a grid, and do a modify grid, and I can give intervals, something like I can give 1000 meter, I'll give, because it is in a UTM projection, the units are in meters. So I'm able to give the grid here. Also, I'm able to draw a frame here outside. And this is how a grid can be visualized on this. Now, in addition, I can also add a title to this map. Simply I can go ahead and do an add label, and I can type here NDVI map. So the moment I do that, it is automatically populated here, and we can visualize this. So in order to export this as a PDF format, we can click here, export to PDF, and this data will be exported to PDF. So I'll just export it to PDF and show it to you. Yeah, so the map has been exported to PDF. I can see it in my desktop. So this is how you can actually, this is what is the basics of QGIS. Now coming to the problem statement, like how we can exploit these tools and these functionalities into our problem statement, which is specific to our interest. So I'll just clear all these layers and I'll start off fresh. So in case of our interest, we require a few layers first. So what we require is, we require some information on hospitals. We also require information on the location of villages with population, administrative information such as the block boundaries, and other auxiliary information such as the road data sets. So I'll just open all these layers first. I've opened the block boundary. I've also opened the village shapefile and the existing hospital shapefile. So we can see here the block boundary is represented in this orange color. The village locations are represented in this blue color, and the green color represents the location of the existing hospitals. So I can click. Now the task is to basically find out the total population within each of these blocks. So how do I do that? Now, if I see here, if I open this attribute table, this is a block in East Khasi Hills district in Meghalaya, and we can see the different block names of East Khasi Hills district, Meghalaya. I want to see the total population for each block. So there's a tool available in QGIS, wherein I'll be joining the population information available in the village layer, which is this, which is represented at T_POPU, okay, with the information of the block layer. So I'll simply go ahead and type join attribute by location summary. Okay, so we have to go for this tool called join attribute by location summary. The moment I do that, in the input layer, I have to type block boundary. And in the join layer, we are joining it with the village locations, that is village locations of East Khasi Hills district. What attribute I have to take as a summary, what attribute I have to summarize is the population attribute. So I'll be clicking on T_population. And what sort of summary I'm taking is, I'm doing a sum. I am finding total population within each block. So I can click OK and I can click run. Now we can see here another layer is created. The moment I click open attribute table, I can see the total population within each block has been populated. The software has calculated it. Another information which we require is, we want to find out the number of hospitals within each block. So we can do that also with the same tool. We can click here. Now I can go ahead and take input layer as the joint layer, and the overlay or the join layer as the hospitals. And here I can take any of the attributes, and in the summarization, I'll be taking count. I can click OK. Now here what I'm getting is, I'm getting two informations here. I'm getting the total population, and also I'm getting the information about the number of hospitals present in each block. In order to find out how much population is one hospital serving for each block, we can do a simple mathematical operation where we can divide the number of hospitals by the total population. So I'll do that operation here and I'll show you how we can do it. So I can just call it hospital index, okay? And here I can search T underscore population underscore sum. So the moment I search here, I'm getting the actual field which I'm finding out. Also, I can divide it by count. So I can just do a count, and it gives me object ID 1 underscore count. So this is my field of interest. And I can change it to a decimal number, the data type, and I can click OK. After that, what is happening is my hospital index is being calculated, where I'm getting in real time what is the number of population each hospital is serving. So here we can see in the case of Mohsin Ram block, it is pretty good. That is, we have around 4,650 people is being served by one hospital. Whereas here it is pretty high. Moflong, there's a block called Moflong where around 23,000 people are being served by one hospital. So this kind of information can be generated where you can do a hospital index. Now, how do I style this layer based on my hospital index is what I'll be showing you. I can go ahead and save this information and I can click here layers. After I click layers, what I have to do is on top here, it shows single symbol. I have to go ahead and click graduated. After I click graduated, I can click on hospital index and then click classify. The moment I click classify, the lower values are represented by white colors and the higher values are represented by red colors. So the higher values actually suggest that these are areas of critical interest where an intervention is actually required for the hospital, for creation of more hospitals or for building more hospitals. Now, there's another aspect on how we can look at this data set is how we can actually calculate the service area. So I'll do a very crude analysis. I won't go for a detailed network level analysis. I'll do a crude analysis where you can do something like a circles around this hospital location, which will actually represent the service area of the hospital. So here, if I go ahead and type buffer, and if I see here, we get multiple options of buffers. So we get single buffer, we get wedge buffers, we get multi-ring buffer, sided buffers, and so on. So let us take a multi-ring buffer, for example. I can click on multi-ring buffer and I can choose the layer for which I want to create the buffer. So I can choose hospitals of the East Kasi district, and I can also choose the number of rings for which number of rings of buffers which I want. So I can see here, I can click 5 rings, and each ring I would like to have it for say 1,000 meters. So 1 kilometer for each ring. And the moment I click run, I get a buffer of the hospitals. So what I'm getting is the service area of all the hospitals. So let us say the innermost circle can be immediately served by a hospital, But whereas the outermost circle is taking time because it is more than 5 kilometers away. And also, we can see some of the gap areas where these areas are not under like immediate coverage of any of the health sectors. So now, if I want to actually identify exactly what are these areas, we can also do something like a difference of these two layers. So I'll just show you how to do the difference of these two layers also. So there's a tool called difference in QGIS. I can click on that. Now I can have the input layer where it is a joint layer, and the overlay layer is the multi-ring hospital buffer. And if I click difference, what I'm getting here is the difference layer. So you can see here, basically these are the layers which are under not immediate coverage of any of the hospitals. So if I just combine these two information, telling that, okay, these areas are under good coverage of hospitals, but these are some of the gap areas. So the white portions have adequate number of hospitals, but they are not completely covered because some of the areas are gap areas, and the red areas require more intervention in the health sector. So here also, these are some of the brown areas which require more intervention, especially in the case of healthcare. Now I can again go ahead and prepare a map for the same. So I'll go ahead and do a new print layout, and I'll do a health map, and I'll click OK, and simply I'll just go ahead, add a map. So the map has been added, and then I'll go ahead and add the scale bar. I'll also add the north arrow. Go ahead, add the grids. So I can click grid on the bottom right here, click modify, and then give the interval for X and Y. Okay. If you check this box, draw coordinates, it actually draws the coordinates in meters. And then I can go ahead and add the title and legend, and I can close this. So I'll go ahead, add the legend here. And add label. And we can see here this map, the grid outside is not being seen. So that can be simply brought on by clicking this frame button. So the moment I click frame, the outside grid is complete. So this is how the different maps can be generated using QGIS software. And you can use these tools for your problem statement, which is specific to your area of interest and specific to your interest. So I'll stop here. And if there are any questions or if there's anything else that needs to be demonstrated, I'll do that also.
Thank you, Mr. Nile. That was really good. So as I said, we will be posting this on the YouTube, and the link to the YouTube will be shared with the ISRO partners. We can look at the YouTube link every 3 days or 2 days and then see if any comments. And I think after the registration, they will start asking questions, like after 18th. To December 31, when the submission is there, they'll try to ask questions, and our teams would be constantly reviewing the questions. If any burning question which is not answered, we will email it to you directly also.